Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Carlton Cuse.
It could not be more fitting that tonight we present the world symphonic premiere of Michael Cicchino's Music for Lost here in Honolulu with the Honolulu Symphony Pops Orchestra. So when you look around at the television landscape, there are really only a few shows that, you know, if you really were to close your eyes, you could identify by their music. You know, and I believe Lost is one of those, and it really is a testament to Michael's genius as a composer. And now it is my great pleasure to introduce our conductor for tonight's performance, Tim Simonek.
The first thing I wrote for Lost was the first scene, was when Jack's eye opens at the very beginning. Just unsettling for me because, you know, plane crashes are never a good thing, and here you are trying to have fun writing music for something like this. I remember thinking it's just really exciting to be a part of something that was going to be different. Almost every single show on television is synthesized. When we first started talking about the music for Lost, we knew we wanted to make sure that we did it live.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we're working on the first episode of a new series called Lost. And again, we are trying to put an orchestra on television.
Whenever you're ready.
Yeah.
As scary and uneasy as the show is, it's also a really emotional show. And, you know, nothing can convey that kind of an emotion as well as live players sitting in a room playing music.
Michael and I talked about at the very beginning of Lost was creating that sense of mystery and the feeling that this island has sort of an epic scale and a scope that is unusual for TV.
So the Honolulu Symphony expressed interest in doing a night of music from Lost, and at every step of the way, I kept thinking, this will never happen, and I didn't want to get my hopes up because it would just be so fun to do, and yet they kept calling, we kept having more meetings, and it just kind of kept bulldozing, getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and then the next thing you knew, we were there in Hawaii doing this thing.
Mai Tai's at 6, right?
6 o'clock.
Are you smiling?
I'll see if I get one of those.
How was it?
It's this beautiful environment. It's a shell called the Waikiki Shell, and it seats about 6,500 people. We thought maybe we can do something magical, and it felt outside of the box.
You guys, I just want to say that, honestly, I'm honored to be here with you guys tonight, because for me, to have this concert take place here in Hawaii is probably the most special thing that could happen for the show and for all of us who've been working on the show for a long time. And there's just nowhere in the world I would rather do it than here with you guys. I'm so happy that we were able to work this out and make this happen.
I'm in complete and utter awe of the music on the show. It is every bit as important of a character as Locke or Jack or Kate or the island.
Chiquinho is one of the, you know, creative linchpins of this show.
He doesn't really need to be told what needs to be there because he knows. He's a storyteller, and it's why it's such a great experience, because you know that he's going to deliver exactly what we need.
Chiquinho is God. Let's be succinct and concise. Chiquinho is God.
You know, they always say, would you like to read the scripts first? And I always say, absolutely not. You know, because I want the music to be as reactive and as just primal as the reactions of the audience watching it. You know, so I want to be as surprised as anyone who's sitting in their living room. So what I do is I sit down with an episode and I'll watch the episode from the very beginning. And the second that I feel that there needs to be music, that's what I'll write, music.
You know, I'm not giving up on you either, Charlie. It's gonna be okay. You're gonna be okay.
You watch a scene when it's just cut without the music and it's there, it's fabulous, but then, you know, you add the music, it just adds so much drama, so much, it can add tension, it can add suspense, or it can add sort of remorse.
We hear that trembling low note on a cello, and all of a sudden we tighten up a little bit, don't we? Because we know something's coming.
I mean, sure, the scene can make your eyes water, but you throw the music on it, you'll cry.
There'll be something where I'm like, oh God, I should have played that stronger, I should have done this, and the music does it. The music kind of lifts you and you're like, thank you. So, love it.
If you have to, kill them.
So I wanted the audience to feel the same way that the characters were feeling. And to me, that was to kind of come up with some kind of strange ensemble of instruments and just use that on a constant basis to score the show. That's been a goal, too, on the show, is to kind of find different ways to use the instruments. To look at the harp and go, well, what else can we do with this thing that you normally wouldn't do with it? Whether you hit it with something or whether you just pluck it with your nail and use them in unexpected ways. While the strings can be used to be very emotional and all of that, we can also use them to just really scratch. And it gives this crazy, frightening sound. We have trombones, of course, which are the big, have become kind of the joke on the show in a way, I guess. The act outs where you hear that kind of thing.
Where are you going?
Find John Locke.
You know, I'm like, you have to stop doing that. And so as a joke, he's like, okay, well, just one per show.
What's that thing it does at the end?
One.
Yeah. Trombone. Those are trombones.
Trombones, yeah. Yeah.
Well, let's talk about the flugelhorn for a minute. I love it.
I used to always refer to it as the flugelhorn because I didn't know what it was. And I kept saying, can we not have the flugelhorn there? So we would perpetually be bickering with each other about having it here but not here, using it there and not there.
Those sounds eventually kind of became the signature sound of the show, which wasn't the original intention. It was just to kind of give some kind of weird, to leave you feeling uneasy in the same way that the show is constantly inventing these stories that are completely unexpected. You know, the idea is to do the same thing with the instruments.
Got a instrument listing, and on the instrument it said airplane wing, and they brought the door from the set.
On the first season, the airplane parts were a big part of the percussion setup.
and they would bang on the airplane things as, and use them as drums, essentially.
I love the show. I watch it all the time, so it's pretty cool to sit back and play it.
Remember, four in, this is number 16.
We had two rehearsals, you know, a few hours each. Each piece we were able to run through once.
I guess I'll start from the beginning.
All right, go ahead.
Let's go, from the beginning. One, two.
I always felt that there should be some sort of kind of through line which connects everything. And I wanted Terry, all from day one, just the only person I thought of was Terry O'Quinn. And I wanted him to do readings of some sort. So the writers got together and wrote these beautiful letters. The conceit is that he walks on with a bottle and it's filled with letters.
You can pull the top one out, and then this can just stay there the whole time.
They'll explain in detail the emotions and the goings-on of people on the island. And with Terry reading it, you can't go wrong, because, come on, the guy's got the greatest voice ever, you know?
Dear Joanna, I remember asking you once, if you were stuck on a deserted island, what would you take with you?
It's been driving me mad thinking about all the things I wish I had, so I got up today and decided to think of all the things I'm glad I left behind. I don't miss money, or traffic, or email.
We wanted the symphony to feel like truly you were immersed in the world of Lost in every way. So from having the hatch open and the smoke come out, or we had torches to represent the others as they ran through the jungle with the flames. We wanted to honor the Hawaiian culture as well, who's so incredibly supportive and immersed into our show and our music. So we brought actual local players in to, with the ukulele player to bring out different parts of the Hawaiian culture.
I think it should just be ukulele. Hey, Tim? Yes. I think that during the uke, when the uke starts, it should be just the ukulele.
Okay.
Not both. So you have the guitar on the faster stuff. The thing about Lost was you never hear it with woodwinds. You never hear it with a lot of, you know, trumpets. You never hear it with many of the instruments that fill out a symphony orchestra. So it, not only were we having to kind of reformat the pieces to fit as concert music, but we also had to reorchestrate everything.
One guy will keep going. Another guy will come in at a different interval.
Okay.
You know, creating this chord.
Like minor thirds or something.
Yeah, and it'll just kind of keep building where it's repeating, but it's building, you know what I mean?
Okay.
Bringing in strings and blah, blah, blah.
Too high for trumpets, perhaps?
Yeah, but the strings and winds would be nice up there.
Yeah.
You know, and then you could have the trumpets underneath.
It was interesting to hear all those familiar melodies, but just in a much bigger sense.
It was fun. I think it was cool because I loved recognizing it and figuring out. I was like, oh yeah, dun 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 dun, dun, you know. It's like, ah, marching, you know, go kill the polar bear, you know, things like that.
The thing that I couldn't have counted on or didn't think about in the beginning was how many themes there would be in the show. Each character ended up with their own theme. Some of them ended up with a couple of themes because certain characters have very distinct storylines that are either one thing or the other. Some of the favorite stuff that I love working with again and again is Hurley's music, because it's such a nice contrast from what the show normally is. Hurley's episodes have a little bit of lightheartedness, and yet there's also this deep sadness. So he's got about three different themes.
16 and 23.
He kind of has his numbers theme, which is about dealing with the fact that he won the lottery. And then he has this awkward theme, which is him kind of, you know, this dum bum 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 bum.
Vixen!
And then you have the true side of the character, which I believe is the scene where he's handing out all the food. The Jin and Sun music has always been fun to do because they have this kind of, you know, epic love story.
A lot to Sun's character and who she is. Whenever we do our episode of Sun and Jin, I make an immediate connection to the music.
The others have this simplistic thing, this low kind of boom, boom, where all the string instruments are just plucking their lowest strings, and then you just wait. There's this uncomfortable silence, and then boom, again, you know? Because again, when they first came in, I was like, I had no clue who these people were. Ben's theme was this really off-putting kind of, with these weird bends in the melody, very kind of uncomfortable and evil. And yet, when we got to the episode that he ended up killing his father, you felt for him because you kind of knew what he went through as a kid. So I was able to turn that kind of evil music into something much more emotional and kind of give you the true side of this character for a moment. So it just gets more complicated as it goes on for me. And it's, you almost need charts to kind of keep track of it all.
It's all relative. Which one was this?
Saeed.
You just don't know where these things go or what they grow into. When Jack gives his speech about how they all need to stick together, and I wrote this piece of music, which eventually became the life and death theme.
If we can't live together, we're gonna die alone.
And as time went on, that theme ended up being used every time someone died or was about to die. And it evolved out of that scene, out of his speech. And it became kind of a storytelling process, making the format work for a concert. Which themes do we choose? Which characters do we kind of use as one piece of music? What characters can we wrap together?
All right, so traveling themes, narration.
Then have him do a narration, and then I'll do the end of Kate, Sawyer, and Jack.
Okay.
we were like, well, we have Jack, Kate, and Sawyer. That's really a triangle there. And all of those stories intertwine with each other. So let's make that one piece of music. And then you have pieces like one was called Under the Knife, which was about when Jack was operating on Ben. And that became its own piece. Concert music, you can kind of just go places you want, you couldn't go on screen. And a lot of the pieces evolved into much bigger thematic pieces than I ever could have played them out on screen on the show. So it was kind of a really freeing experience.
Watching the symphony was a reminder of how iconic our show is. I'm actually not just doing something mundane and everyday. I'm doing something extraordinarily special.
It was a perfect combination of music, spoken word, and beautiful writing.
And it was kind of fun to legitimize it in a way to do a performance of it. And going to be a part of it.
We are lucky. We get to do something we love, but it's even better when you can then share that with the people directly. We're working on getting it packaged so that we can bring it to different cities, different countries.
The symphony performance was one of those great moments that will always stand out to me in my history on Lost. To see Michael Cicchino with the Honolulu Symphony up there, getting all of the well-deserved recognition for what he contributes to the show was just so powerful. First season of the show, the scene of the raft launch is just the most beautiful, moving, and emotional thing. And that moment came full circle when we did the symphony and Michael actually conducted and played that piece of music, in front of an audience out there in the trade winds on the beautiful grassy slope. It was really just a fantastic experience.
Was so beautiful that it's something that I can hear 20 years from now, even like 5 seconds of it, and it will bring me right back to when we were shooting that sequence.
I think bad music tells you how to feel, and good music takes what you're already feeling and enhances it, and Cicchino is always clearly in the latter category.
The first time that, they set sail on the raft that they built, It was like, I defy you to find a movie that feels as epic and as emotional and sweeping as that. If you watch that sequence without the sound on, it is a different experience. And I feel like to look at Lost without Michael Giacchino is not to look at Lost.
I can't imagine any other show that would allow me to do as much as I've been able to do with the music as this show. And I think it will always be something, at least for me, that I look back on as one of the best things I ever got to work on.